Hello, I'm Richard Ager. Welcome to New Hampshire Outlook. During her distinguished career in journalism, Gwen Ifill has broken a number of barriers, including becoming the first African-American woman to host a national political talk show. She has now hosted Washington Week for a decade and become a senior correspondent of the PBS NewsHour. And through it all, the subject of race and how America responds to it has been a constant. From witnessing racist slurs to covering the election of our first black president, Gwen Ifill has written about and spoken about race while maintaining a journalist's perspective. I spoke with Gwen Ifill during NHPTV's Women of Influence event in November. Well, Gwen Ifill, welcome to New Hampshire Outlook.
Thank you.
To the beginnings, you grew up number five of six children, a daughter of a preacher. What was expected of you as a daughter of a preacher?
Well, first of all, everybody was watching all the time. When you're a preacher's kid, everybody feels like they own some part of you, and you learned how to behave just in case someone was watching.
So you're on from an early
exactly.
age.
Exactly. but truthfully, my father really was a kind of a social justice preacher in many respects. So he was very engaged in the world around him and the possibility that government or politics or civil rights could change our lives. So we always saw the connection from early on that something that speaking up or participating could have a direct connection on the life you lived. And so as a result, I think all of his children came away with this understanding that public service was a good thing, that engagement was a good thing. And I also grew up in the 60s, and so I saw the connection between people marching in the streets and laws getting passed. So I think that even without being conscious of it at the time, we took all those lessons.
Now, I read also that your daily diet included the nightly news.
It's true. We watched the news first thing in the morning. We got afternoon papers at our house, so we'd come home from school and the newspaper would be there. We believed everything in it was God's truth.
to this that's day. The way it is, right?
Yeah, that's the way it is. And as a result, I was always exposed.
You went on to get an education with Simmons College. I'm wondering, what made you decide to settle on journalism?
You know, I decided very early on I wanted to be a journalist. I was probably 9 years old. I decided I liked to write a lot. It was really fun for me to write, and I also decided that I needed a deadline because I couldn't get any of it done. And so by reading newspapers and seeing it at the house, I saw the connection between actually writing something, getting it done, and then putting a byline on it, which was a really nice way of getting credit for the work you did and satisfying your curiosity at the same time. So journalism seemed the only place I could end up.
Now, being near Boston, you got an internship at the Boston Herald American, a major paper, but not an entirely pleasant experience.
Well, you know, I got that internship when I was a junior in college, and I worked there for the summer as a gopher. I went for this, I went for that, and we got along fine. I was unlike anything anyone in that newsroom had ever seen at the time, which is to say I was an educated black woman, and there weren't a lot of those around in the newsroom at the Boston Herald American. But when it came time for me to leave and go back to school, shortly before I left, I came to work one day and I found a note with a racial slur on it at my workspace. And I thought, my first thought was, I wonder who this is for. But my second thought, which tells you a little bit about the way I saw myself, I didn't see myself as that kind of name, the N-word. And I decided to show it to my boss, who was horrified. And he showed it to his boss, who was horrified. And even though it was an off-putting experience, their response was to say, we're so sorry this happened. If you ever need a job, come back and work here. And my response initially was, never. I will never work with these racists. A year later, when I was looking for a job, it looked really good that there was an offer on the table. So that's how I got in to working in a newsroom. Even though I was doing entry-level work, it got me a chance to get in. And then once I was there, I could perform.
Well, you know, in your book, The Breakthrough, Politics and Race in the Age of Obama, you begin coming off of that experience at the Herald American. I learned how to cover race riots by telephone. They didn't pay me enough at my first news job to venture onto the grounds of South Boston High School. So how did you end up covering that story?
I was being paid $13,000 a year, exactly. I would call the headmaster on the phone and say, what happened that day? I'd say, how many chairs were broken, essentially, in Southie? And then a white colleague would go in, would report, and would bring back information for me to complete the story. So if you look at those stories now, they were always double bylines because it was me writing from the office where it was safe, and my white colleague who could actually go on site. And even then, I was pretty matter of fact about this. This was just how you had to go about it. I didn't spend a lot of time raging at the unfairness of it all. I just did my job.
You know, and looking back at your book, you write, in the year 1977, and I quote, "Boston was awash in the sort of racial drama that foreshadows dramatic change." I'm wondering what sort of change, how would you characterize the change that has come since then?
Well, it's interesting. When I started writing this book, I had a very simplistic idea of what it was going to be. It was going to be a story about black educated people who had given access to things their parents were denied, could now break through and run for mayor and governor. It seemed really simple. But as I kept reporting it, I found out it was so much more complicated. There were cities like Atlanta where the breakthrough was, or even in Alabama where the breakthrough were black officials who came up into power during the civil rights movement, now giving up that power to a younger generation of black people. It was people within families who didn't have a basic agreement about things like school vouchers. They're all African American, but they were handing power off. And whenever power is handed off, whether it's, you know, the Brahmins to the Irish, or in New York, whether it was, you know, the Italians to the Jews, there became this, I want my power. It wasn't so much about the ethnicity.
So you had no idea, of course, always at the time, that Obama was going to end up where he ended up.
It's embarrassing how little idea I had.
And it's kind of like you were writing, wanted to write about an undercurrent, and then it became a riptide.
Yeah. I had this, the publisher wanted me to write a book about Barack Obama, next black president. At this point, I thought that was a ridiculous notion. And so I said, how about this idea instead that talked about Deval Patrick in Massachusetts and Cory Booker in Newark and Artur Davis in Alabama, and how Barack Obama is not the only one.
When did you first seriously develop the idea this guy could actually do it?
Well, you know, the first time I met him, interestingly enough, was on the podium at the 2004 Democratic National Convention, right after he had given that big speech. We had prearranged that we were going to interview this guy who's giving the keynote speech for the NewsHour, with the understanding that he was the Senate candidate from Illinois.
Just the Senate candidate? What's he doing getting a keynote speech?
Yeah, we knew there was something, there was a lot of buzz, but we didn't, you know, no one was thinking presidency. He wasn't thinking it. When he came off the stage that night, the place was on fire, it was just, everything was sparkly. And he walked over to where I stood, he and Michelle Obama, and for this interview, and they both had this dazed look in their eyes. And I had a dazed look in my eye because I was standing facing that room. It was remarkable. So I thought, this is a remarkable moment. And I thought nothing more of it. I think I asked him a dumb question like, how do you feel or something. And he was like, I just hope I didn't screw up. That was his answer to the question. So now, 4 years later, no one expected, certainly he, that he would be the one standing on that stage accepting the nomination.
You know, you write a fair amount also in the book about the man who had gotten the furthest before Obama, which was Jesse Jackson, with his runs in 1984 and even more in 1988. I'm wondering how you differentiated in looking at how Jesse had done it and gotten as far as he did, as opposed to how Obama was doing it.
I don't think that Reverend Jackson got enough credit for what he was able to do in 1984 and 1988. He won 13 contests in 1988. He lasted all the way to the Democratic National Convention and challenged Michael Dukakis to pay attention to him. He even wanted the vice presidency and didn't get it. But by laying the groundwork, people forget that one of the things that Reverend Jackson did was he created a true rainbow coalition. He got support from white voters, from Latino voters, and he, for a lot of people, he was the first introduction they'd had to the idea that you could vote for a black person for president. So when Barack Obama came along 10 years, 14 years later, a lot of that had already been addressed. It seemed conceivable because of Reverend Jackson. And Reverend Jackson didn't, I think, in some ways get the credit he deserved for having laid that groundwork.
Now, another major figure, General Colin Powell, there was a huge amount of interest in him way back in 1995. How much do you think he helped pave the way for Barack?
My boss, Tim Russert, at the time at NBC, was one of the people who really thought that Powell was going to do it. And he really was into the idea of it. But I think that it was just a little bit ahead of his time. His wife, Alma, didn't think this was a safe time for a black man to run for president. He also said he didn't feel that that was his calling, that his calling to public service was his calling to the military, his calling since retirement to work on children's programs and on behalf of neglected groups like the Buffalo Soldiers. He just didn't necessarily think being president was the only way that he could serve. And in order to run for president, you have to really believe somewhere deep down in a way that will get you through all the hard parts that this is something that only you can do and something you should do. And he just wasn't there, and he knew it.
You know, you brought up the case of Doug Wilder, first black governor of Virginia, and he became bitter, it sounded, in your book, because he felt he'd been promised a lot by a number of different people. He ended up saying, "They lied to me. They will always lie." And you quote him as saying, "Racism is never going away."
He actually believed that, and he also believed that he would have gotten more support but for his race, even when he won, even in the year that he won. He subscribes to a notion of what some people call the Bradley theory, which was after Tom Bradley, the mayor of Los Angeles, ran for governor of California, and he lost by so much more than anyone expected than the final polls had shown. People said maybe this was because of race, that people went into the polls and voted differently than they said. They also said it would happen with any other black candidate for statewide races and higher. They said it would happen for Barack Obama. But when you look at the final numbers, especially at the Obama race, more white people voted for Barack Obama than for John Kerry 4 years before. What does that mean? Who are those people? Was it race that was driving that? Perhaps it was a bigger issue than race. Perhaps race is a big factor in our society, but not the factor or the defining conclusion that folks draw.
Now, as a reporter covering major candidates in a number of these contests, I'm sure over time you develop your own feelings about them, but how do you remain unbiased?
I get that question a lot from young people, in part because they can't imagine that there is any kind of journalism that's not opinion journalism. And I came up at an age where no kind of journalism was opinion. It was always straight ahead. So it's never really been hard for me, because I feel like if I form an opinion about a candidate, then I stop listening for things. I remember once I went to cover Pat Robertson, the evangelist, when he was running for president. And I remember going in there with a preconception that this crowd was going to be, I don't know, a little biased, a little rube. I didn't know. All I know is when I walked in that room, everybody there were regular folks who were just worried about their kids and worried about their futures. That's why they were coming to talk to listen to Pat Robertson. And I found that even though the crowds were mostly white, they had a lot in common with crowds that were mostly black who were going to see Jesse Jackson. They were opposite ends of the political spectrum, but they were speaking the same kind of truths, or at least people were hearing the same kind of truths from both of them. So that taught me that politics is politics, but what people are hearing and what they're seeing and why they're voting is based on things much more profound and things we have a lot more in common.
You know, in 2008, you also served as the moderator for the vice presidential debate. And 2 days before the debate, the fact of your partially completed book about Obama became news and, in some people's eyes, disqualified you from that debate. Now, you did it anyway. It seemed to work out, but how did you deal with that?
You know, it's interesting. I learned a lot because I'm not, as you point out, I'm not used to being in the middle of the vortex. And in fact, I really don't do well. But fortunately, I was so much focused on the debate and getting the debate done that I was protected in lots of ways from this little drama that came up. I realized that I had written several articles talking about this book. So it had been out there. People knew it existed. So the fact that it came up 2 days before the debate signaled to me that someone was trying to use it as a battering ram to shake me up. And that part was fine. What I wanted to make sure, however, that people understood, because I cared about my reputation, I spent 30 years trying to be right down the middle, was that I hadn't written the Obama chapter yet. And part of the reason I hadn't written is because I didn't know how it was going to end. And I was not rooting for him consciously, because I was trying to hold out the possibility of all kinds of outcomes. So I focused all my energy, and it was quite a lot of energy, because you're working full time, covering a campaign like this full time, and writing a book, and all the other chapters about the other people, about women in politics, and about the other breakthroughs, and purposely was holding back on the Obama piece. And to the extent I'd written anything, I kept putting biographical stuff in and then rewriting that. So I hadn't decided where I was landing or the conclusion. Much to my publisher's frustration, it should be said, I had not finished any of this. So a lot of the dust up was trying to shake up the ref, part of it. And part of it was raising, just planting the idea in people's minds that a black moderator couldn't be fair to a black candidate, even though, he wasn't on the stage. It was actually Joe Biden and Sarah Palin. So after a while, you just sit back, you understand what's going on, you understand there's a game that's being played, and you don't play along.
I'd like to jump to that summer night in Denver, because the first thing that you actually write about it is you say, "I do not believe this to be a post-racial moment." But what was your meaning of that term, and why did you feel it necessary to make that distinction, just as the or much of the nation was celebrating their first black nominee?
I think it's great that he's their first black nominee, but to suggest that you don't want something to be post-racial suggests there's something wrong with race. Why? I find that we're not really good at viewing race as a positive. The idea that I don't wake up every morning bemoaning my terrible fate of being born African American surprises some people. I think it's a good thing. I think it adds something to my life. I don't think it has anything to do with anybody else's life necessarily. So to say let's transcend race or let's get past race suggests to me you think there's something wrong. Because if you thought it was good, you wouldn't want to get past it. So how do we value the politics of difference? What's different about us without devaluing the other person's essence? And that's what I mean when I say we're not post-racial, because I don't know that we need to be.
Because according to that theory, there'd be no more Caribbean restaurants, no more Japanese restaurants.
At the very least, our cuisine would suffer.
You know, you do quote Julian Bond, who now serves as the NAACP chairman, and his concern about the decline of discrimination as a side effect in its diminishing of the common bonds that unite the black population. And that brought to mind, actually, the questions throughout the campaign about whether Barack was black enough.
It was one of the most infuriating moments of the campaign, where people kept asking him, are you black enough? I talked to the mayor of Philadelphia, who's African American. He said, what does that mean? Does that mean that my pants don't hang low? Does it mean I'm supposed to turn my hat to the side? What does that mean, being black enough? And people, I think it often came from other black people. They're asking, and I realized after I broke it down that what people weren't asking wasn't about skin color. It was asking about authenticity. It was asking, do you speak for me? When white voters said, I don't know if he's too black, what they meant was, this guy, Jeremiah Wright, is that who he is? That guy scares me. Does he speak for me? So when we start to put these definitions on who people are and whether they're enough of something or too much of something else, it's code for saying, will you represent me? And every elected official, whether you're a city council president or a dog catcher or a governor or a president, only gets elected if they convince voters that they are going to represent their interests. And that is all I've decided that these questions about people's authenticity is ever about, whether it's about racial authenticity or whether it's about you're just too rich to be like me, or you're just too poor to be like me, or you're too rural or too urban. It all boils down to how much of my interests do you share?
You know, you're referring to the sometimes overt racism during the campaign. You wrote that it's hard to pick a favorite outrage. There were men who wore monkey shirts, elected officials who called them uppity. I mean, how do you not make too much of the crazies at the fringe of the crowd?
I could have written a whole chapter about the crazies at the fringe of a crowd, but I didn't do that because I didn't want to give it too much. You have to acknowledge it's out there. The question is, how much weight do you want to give it? I think you acknowledge it's there, and you don't overreact to it.
And how important do you think his speech on race was, you know, following the Reverend Wright?
It was very effective in the short term, which is all he needed right then. At that point, his campaign advisors told me later they thought this might derail the entire campaign, with the understanding that they had very successfully managed to do what all candidates want to do, which is make people think we're more alike than different. And instead, up comes this guy who says, no, he's very different from you. They had to find a way to calm that down and be true to his true feelings about race. And he pulled it off, and it saved the campaign. So in the short term, it saved the campaign, and in the long term, it let them fight another day, because the race issue is never going away.
This is a provocative quote from Michael Dyson, and he wrote that the key was for Obama to wink at black America while speaking to white America.
You know, it's interesting. In the paperback version, I have an afterword in which I talk about some of the critics who popped up after he was elected. And Michael Dyson is one of them. He was a supporter of Barack Obama throughout. But after Barack Obama was in office for a few months, he began to publicly complain he hadn't been invited to the White House, or that Barack Obama was not being true to certain racial bona fides that he had hoped he would be. He and Cornel West, a Princeton professor, a couple of people were very overtly critical, have been very overtly critical. So I asked the president about that a couple months ago when I was researching the updated part of the book, and his response was, you know, I care more about what the bus driver thinks than the intellectuals, and there are always going to be critics out there. So he gave the impression that he lets it roll off his back, and perhaps he does.
Now, I want to briefly also mention another book that it's The Obamas, The Portrait of America's First Family. You wrote some articles in that. You had amazing access for, I guess it was Essence Magazine.
Well, you know, it's very interesting, the different kinds of publications. That point that I did the interviews for The Obamas for Essence was a couple different times. They were very, this was during the Is He Black Enough phase, they were very much interested in signaling who they were to the African American community, and that's, Essence is a black women's magazine. And they really wanted to say, look at us, we're wholesome, we're normal. And so I spent some time with the Obamas while doing those articles. And it told people, I think for the first time, for that audience at least, who were they? I was around them enough to see that, to watch them interact away from the public eye a little bit, and to watch their reactions, their interactions with their children, which seemed very genuine and real, and which a whole lot of people get. So it was, when you are trying to get to know someone who might be president of the United States, all that detail matters. Now it's been blown up even larger than life with them at the White House, but it was the first time that people said, oh, he's a family guy. What do we know about that?
Conclusions. I'm wondering, maybe this is the end of the firsts.
Well, I've often been called a first, and it's something I don't think about very much, but which people say, what does it feel like to be the first African-American host of a public television program, of a public television weekly program? And you know, you don't spend a lot of time thinking about that. You just do your job. And so after a while, it gets a little bit, am I really still the first? It gets a little exhausting. So it's nice to have a breakthrough at this level where it's hard to question what African-Americans are capable of once you've had a black president.
You know, in the three decades that you have been in journalism, what would you say has been the biggest change that you've seen?
Technology. There is just no question. I couldn't have written this book if I had been doing what I used to do when I did research, which is going to the library and getting microfiche and turning it slowly. And
that made me dizzy.
Yeah. It was, I mean, this was not, I'm not that old. It was in my lifetime that this is the way you did research. You had to physically go and be there. Now I could see any campaign speech I wanted online, anything. I could find out, if I couldn't find it out online, I could find it out secondarily. It was remarkable, the access to things you had. And if you didn't know what your choices were this year, it's because you weren't paying attention. And that to me has made reporting and journalism easier. Sometimes you get lazy with it because it seems like everything's at your fingertips, and nothing substitutes for actually coming to New Hampshire and seeing the primary as opposed to watching it at a distance. So that to me is what's made the biggest difference just in the time that I have been in journalism.
You know, you mentioned the primary. What is your sense of the value of the New Hampshire primary in the political process?
I think it's very valuable. Every 4 years we have this debate again, should New Hampshire be first? Why are they better than we are? Usually it's an Iowa discussion. But I think it's actually great for us to get out of our bubbles, talk to individuals, voters who are taking it seriously, who are debating it, and who are laying the groundwork for what comes next. Even if that New Hampshire isn't representative of the rest of the country, it gives us a chance to watch these candidates, not as intimate as it used to be, but watching them perform, watching what their messages are, watching them hone it, find out how good they are at what they do in smaller or at least more intimate settings. And that is invaluable. There's no other way you can do that when you're spending all your time on a plane flying from tarmac to five different states in a day. It's just more like old-fashioned politics here.
You know, we have seen such a profusion of cable shows, a lot of them shouting shows, but you prefer to stand against that, don't you?
Yeah, I do. I really believe that we stand for light rather than heat, and that it's important that people can watch whatever they want, and there's lots of information out there. I just think there also ought to be a place where people can go where they can say, huh, I didn't know that. Let me decide what I think about it, not just let you decide what you think about it and then tell me what to think.
So you never wanted to say wrong?
Never. Never tempted at all, because you know what? I might be wrong, and I usually am wrong. So I prefer to let other people make the judgments.
Well, Gwen Ifill, thank you for joining us.
Thank you. Thank you. This was delightful.
All right. And that's all we have time for this week. I'm Richard Ager. We'll see you next time on New Hampshire Outlook. Our thanks to Citizens Bank, the University System of New Hampshire, and Charter Charitable Foundation, sponsors of NHPTV's Women of Influence event.